You're listening to In the Moment on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Lori Walsh. Well, poetry returns to the stage this weekend in Sioux Falls as poets Patrick Hicks and Chris Vondracek read at Full Circle Book Co-op. Today, we are going to bring just a little bit of that poetry to the rest of the state as well, because Patrick and Chris have kindly agreed to step into SDPB's Kirby Family Studio in Sioux Falls, books in hand, to join us on the air. Chris, welcome back.
Hi, Larry. Good to be here.
Patrick, welcome as well.
Oh, it's always a pleasure.
All right, let's talk a little bit for listeners who haven't met you yet about some of the wide variety of things that you do, because Chris, your book, Rattlesnake Summer, you're also a journalist.
Yes.
Who has covered politics in Pierre, mm-hmm. agriculture in Minnesota, mm-hmm. Politics in Washington, D.C., mm-hmm. and probably a whole lot of things that I do not know about, but you have this multi-layered, rambling career. Yes.
Series of essays I'm working on about Terry Redlin, actually, the painter.
Nice.
Yeah,
okay.
Sorry if anyone's out there. I felt like it's spring, finally. I mean, at least back in Minnesota, it's been very dreary the last few months.
Yeah.
And so I felt kind of like, you know, this was a good time for poetry. I know National Poetry Month is April, so we're mm-hmm. a little bit on the heels of that. But you don't really ever need a good reason to get together and have some reading. And it is First Friday in beautiful downtown Sioux Falls tonight. So, yeah.
Yes. Patrick Hicks, writer in residence at Augustana University,
yeah.
also a novelist and an essayist, a short story writer, a poet. Collections of poetry include Adoptable, This London, Library of the Mind. Thanks for coming back.
I really enjoy this is a good lunch break for me, so thank you, Lori.
I want to talk, because I bring up the various areas that you both work to get to sort of a first question, which is switching between those kinds of minds. Mm. Your novelist mind, your fiction mind, your teaching professor Hicks mind, and then sitting down to work with poetry. Tell me a little bit about how those things work together or work in opposition to each other sometimes.
Sometimes they work in opposition, but more often than not, there's a great deal of harmony there. But writing is a part of my life from the moment I wake up until the moment I go to bed. I mean, I'm working with words. I'm working teaching creative writing. I'm working on my own material. I'm an editor, so it's what I do. So it's all encapsulated into that word writer. But even as a professor at Augustana University, I'm quick to say that I'm a writer first and a teacher second, and I model what it means to be a writer to my student and students. And I really love when they bring me poems and they bring me short stories, and I can see that they're putting together ideas in a really sort of elegant way that will help their story or their poem really blossom open and become better.
Mm-hmm. Mary Oliver used to say that she gave her paying job her very second best to her poetry. And I'm not sure employers want to hear that. But my question, though, is like priority. You know, you're writer first, professor second. You're an excellent professor, of course. How do you make that distinction? Is it about time spent? Is it about I'm going to do this part at the beginning of the day? Is this about identity?
Wow, it's a good question. I start the day wondering, okay, when can I work on my own writing? And I'll budget meetings around that and my classes around that. I'm a morning writer, so mm-hmm. I'm usually in my office by about 6:30 or 7, and I'll write for several hours. But it's not just that. I mean, I model what it means to be a writer for my students. And today, for example, a little plug for this, Augustana's literary annual, which has existed for over 65 years, it's called Venture. And at 4:00 today in the Arts Atrium at Augustana University, it's going to be, we have our big publication party and the unveiling of the best poems and short stories and 10-minute plays. And
nice.
I just couldn't be more proud of our two student co-editors.
Nice. Chris, same idea, journalism and poetry, essays and reporting, how do they intersect in your life?
Well, I have like a physically different space that I write in. And so, for example, I just started this job about a month ago as the agriculture reporter for the Star Tribune, and they have these like beautiful offices on the 12th floor of the Capella building, and it's like a Mad Men thing where I go up there and it's like, you know, beautiful. And like, I actually, the first day I was there and I had to, and I was producing copy, there was a moment of pause that I had. It was like almost a little bit of panic because my laptop was plugged into a bigger screen. and people could see what I was writing, you know? And mm-hmm. it was just like, this is a physical different, like a physically different space for me. And even though it's my journalism brain, I still had a moment of kind of like performance anxiety or something. And then it was fine because I started writing the sentence like, oh yeah, this is, it's like in the movie Hoosiers when they're like, they take the tape measure out, you know? And they're like, the rim is 10 feet, right? Right. Anyway. So, but like for creative writing, for whether it's poetry, which a lot of the poems out of Rattlesnake Summer I wrote in D.C., like on our couch in our home in D.C. And like me, like often in the dark early in the morning, and it was like East Coast time, so even earlier in the morning for Central, and it was like me imagining the state often like in darkness, and like the little thing I was going to illuminate was like a picture. And so I think similarly for the stuff I'm working on now, I'm often, as my wife can attest, I get up early, try not to wake her, tiptoe downstairs, and I'm writing in the morning when it makes most sense for me. And I'm often either at the kitchen table or at the couch. Although I know that in Stephen King's memoir, he talks about once getting like a large desk when he was trying to do his novel. I think it also like aligned with some chemical dependency issues that he had, but he had to get rid of that desk because he was like, it was too big and he needed something a little bit more humble. So I very much am interested though in that fit. Like to me physically, I know, or at a coffee shop too, for some reason with that white noise of like the hissing of the espresso machine, I can like tap into a more of a creative mindset than to sort of write, whether it's like fiction or non, or sort of like a essayistic nonfiction.
So when I read Rattlesnake Summer, I imagine you're in your car sometimes.
Yes, that, well, my friend Altman Studeni did some paintings of me, and I did travel, you know, to do the reporting for that. I did a lot of travel, and so I was in my car a lot. And so I love that you think that, but truly it was like it's Rembrandt, you know what I mean? When it's like, it's like a black canvas and then there's like a little farmhouse with a tiny little light on or something, you know, like that's often when I was writing them. That's why I was trying to just get the most, you know, essential details on the page.
I want to talk about love, because if you're going to spend an entire book writing about a poem for every county in South Dakota, if you're going to spend an entire poetry collection writing about adopting your son or writing about London or writing about the next thing that you're going to write about, you have to love it enough to spend enough time with that. Patrick, you first on that one.
Absolutely.
Devotion.
And when it comes to poetry collections, I like to have my poems orbit around a particular subject, like the adoption of our son, or like the city of London, which I love very much. Mm-hmm. And it helps me, it focuses my attention, it acts as a center of gravity that holds the whole collection together. And I really do need to have that moment of also wanting to explore something that I don't know. And I get really excited when I come up with a new book idea and I'm trying to work my way into, you know, how to write the book and what is the book about. I've just finished a book which I'll send off to my publisher soon, and I've already started the next book, which is going to be about my home state of Minnesota, and I'm just really excited to dive into that.
No, love counties, hate counties. Like
right.
What's?
Oh my gosh. Well, I do think that there is a certain it's like a dipstick, and sometimes I can tell that there is not love for the subject that I'm writing on, and I don't always know if it's going to sustain then through a whole project. Mm-hmm. And that has happened sometimes with certain writing projects where I get a little bit into them and I think I'm not obsessed about this. Mm-hmm. And it's not so much that I have to sort of narcissistically only, but like I think almost functionally I cannot, because a project takes, you know, months and months and years, mm-hmm. you know, like for my Lawrence Welk book, like that took, you know, I graduated from USD in 2007 with my undergraduate degree. And that's when I basically, that summer, I went on this tour with a band and it was tumultuous, and like Lawrence Welk was involved, and I don't want to get into that right now. But like it was like, you know, like that, working through that has taken 15 years. And finally the book's coming out this summer, but it's like, you know. Yeah, just not a lot.
It is a labor of love. It's a creative book.
I am hoping we can bring some of this poetry that folks will hear at Full Circle tonight to the rest of the state who can't make it to that poetry reading. So very generous of you to show up and do that. Chris, will you read
sure.
first?
Sure. I actually have, this is like very serendipitous, I have a love poem pulled up, and this is for Moody County, and it's called A Dithyram for Moody County. Outside the courthouse in Flandreau, truck doors slam, keys lob over console, parents watch from lobby at the khakis, bobby pins, eyeshadow, and full red lips. Weeks earlier, Cal, with glasses down his nose, typed at the family computer while his wife, Sherry, watched a casserole spinning on an amber microwavable plate. Their son had stolen bushels of corn from their operation. Ryan wouldn't do that, Sherry said. But he did, Cal replied. So they'd sued. Now, Ryan and Teresa sit in the cab of the F-150, navy with white trim, before driving off in the rain. Tires slosh wet potholes. North of town, past the Indian school, a police SUV saunters down the Big Sioux, looking for stray dogs. It's not what a parent ought to do, says Teresa. Scraggly, brown corn so dry it creaks. On the interstate, trucks cross horizons. At Coleman, a sign on the highway. Pregnant, scared, with a phone number. Teresa thinks she sees an elk on the off-ramp before it disassembles. Torso, head, only a sign. Legs, the metal rods. When she comes to Ryan in the garage that night, under a lamp, working on a harvester scout, he'll roll out from beneath the engine, grease-stained hands pulling her onto casters, their forms rolling under the shattered sky, enwrapped like they were in the plastic backyard pool for their only son's birth.
Thank
Lovely.
You.
Thanks.
Thank you. Chris Vondracek, the book is called Rattlesnake Summer. You can come see him tonight in a poetry reading with Patrick Hicks, Full Circle Book Co-op, downtown Sioux Falls, 6 p.m.
Yeah.
Patrick, what would you like to read for us, please?
Well, I'm a man that loves words, and it's how I make my living, but words also need to be protected. And I'm aware that there are people in this state that are banning books, and that's very worrisome to me. And I would encourage those high school kids to seek out these books. They're not dangerous. So I'm going to read a poem that's about words. So this is the poem, Words. Words can bind wounds or slit skin. They doze in the skull's honeycomb. They quiver the voice box, twitch the muscled tongue, pulse across the vast space between us, and tap against the door of an ear. Words can be as warm as fresh bread or as flinty as an arrowhead piercing the aorta's wall. Words can build up a child or tear down empires. Words can resurrect the dead. In the silence of the looming last page, the gateway at the bottom of the page, where the end begins and the bullet hole of a period finds its mark, watch how words flutter away like leaves on a river of wind.
Patrick Hicks reading from Library of the Mind. I was going to ask you, what are people so afraid of when they try to ban books? But I don't have to ask you that because you just answered it.
Maybe that's for another show.
Go read the poem.
Yeah. Read widely.
Yes. Tonight, how will it work back and forth between the two of you?
I think we're going to arm wrestle. Is that it? I'm not sure.
I think we'll maybe just draw straws, perhaps. Yeah. I'm bringing my piano, too. I'm not certain if the bookstore knows this. I'm going to maybe set that up, too. So maybe we'll just have it. And Angelica's reading, too. Angelica Mercado Ford.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
She's also reading. So she's a Sioux Falls poet.
Okay.
And so I'm very excited to have her. So, between the three of us, we'll figure out some.
Yeah. It'll be entertaining. And,
say something about these spaces, because you mentioned the geography and having a desk or having an office or, you know, switching spaces to go do the work that needs to be done. Then there are places like an independent bookstore, like Mitzi's in Rapid City, like Full Circle Book Co-op here in Sioux Falls that host these events and become cultural hubs. How important, Patrick, are these third spaces?
Oh, they're vitally important. I mean, when Chris and I write, it's a private sort of space, but then the book comes out, and this is it's a public forum where we get to meet and interact with our readers. And more than that, I mean, these bookstores become the beacons of liberty and intellectual nourishment. You know, you don't see bookstores banning books. So I really appreciate the necessary work that either new bookstores or used bookstores are all about. And just a couple of days ago, we brought Gary Goodman on campus at Augustana, and I know he was on your show, and he talked about how important bookstores are.
Mm. We needed more time with him.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Chris,
yeah. I was just going to say quickly, you know, if you're like myself and you look askance at social media and sometimes look at it pathologically, right, that it's like, well, okay, but we do want a forum, right? We do want the sort of Socrates, was it the agora, whatever, like the public space, the forum, right? If we want that somewhere in society, it's going to happen maybe at the diner. It's going to happen at these bookstores, right? And so it's these third places. It's you know, in line at the grocery store. And I think that bookstores provide that kind of, you know, that's not the function of them, but the latent effect of them is that people can sit and think about ideas and talk about ideas.
Yeah, and it's a wonderful moment when you, as a writer, stand up in front of a crowd and you can hear their quiet, and there's that connection that story can bring.
Yeah.
And I really love that that space of silence, and it's the silence that binds the reader and the listener.
Fantastic. All right, tonight, 6 o'clock, you might want to go early. Full Circle Book Co-op, Christopher Vondracek. The book is called Rattlesnake Summer. Patrick Hicks read from Library of the Mind. He also has other collections and novels and short story collections as well. We'll put some links up to all of that on our website, sdpb.org/news. Gentlemen, thank you.
Thank you so much, Lori.
Yep.